Good morning. There's one thing for sure is that we have fun here. Amen? Well, you know, it's summer's here. Yeah, we got the heat out there. It's typical. The air conditioner's not working the way it should. Not blowing cold enough air anyway. One of the fans is not working right, so all of those hot-blooded women moved over that side. And there's Mike on this one and Mike on that one, kind of in between them all. I guess I could say Mike and Mike are in with all the hot ladies. That's right, that's right. So good for you guys. Good for you. Well played. If you are watching online on YouTube, we say good morning to you and welcome to First Baptist Church. Welcome, and I'm Pastor Mark. If that's not where you're supposed to be, you're supposed to be watching cartoons. Sometimes we can be entertaining. So stay tuned. So let's get started like we always do. Let's bow our heads and pray and ask God's Spirit to get rid of any of that stuff in our hearts that keeps us from being able to worship Him this morning. He deserves it. He deserves it every day. But today, you woke us up. You allowed us another day, another start. Too often, when we close our eyes, we're filled with worry. We're anxious about life. Too often we wake up in the morning and we're still anxious. We forget that you give us another chance, another day, a fresh beginning every day. And while some problems are still there the next day, you give us the opportunity to look at them with new eyes, with a fresh attitude. I pray that this morning as we meet here as your children, that you would just touch our hearts in a way that just takes away any of that stuff that takes away from us being able to give ourselves completely to you this morning. And Lord, you are good indeed. You love us so much that you sent your Son to die for us. This morning, as we continue on, Father, we ask your blessing. Ask your blessing on the music, on the fellowship, on the words that are spoken, on every man, woman, and child here. We're thankful for all that you give us as we commit all that we say and all that we do to you. In the precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, all God's children said, amen. We will be reading out of the Gospel of Mark today, chapter 3, verses 22 through 30. 3, 22 through 30. Divided equals fall. Webster's Universal College Dictionary defines the word divided as separated or separate, disunited, shared, apportioned, talking about a leaf cut into distinct portions by incisions extending to the midrib or base. That could be about our life too, amen? If we've learned anything over the past year about ourselves and about our society, we've learned a whole lot about being divided. Amen? We've seen division in all parts of our lives, starting with our families, with our own house. I'm going to let you in on a little bit of secret. Pastors don't like division. We don't like it. I don't like it when people try it. I don't like when people are doing it, and people do it all the time. You'd think that Christians wouldn't like division either, wouldn't you? John Calvin said, "If Christians hated division as much as they hated those who disagree with them, then we would have won the world." There's a story about the British and French. They were fighting in Canada in the 1750s. And Admiral Phipps was the commander of the British fleet. And he was told by the supreme commanders to anchor outside of Quebec. He was given orders to wait there until the British ground troops got there, and then he would lend support from the ships. Well, Phipps got there early. As the admiral waited, he became annoyed at the statues of the saints that adorned the towers of the nearby cathedral. So the commander, the admiral, commanded his men to shoot at those statues of the saints with his cannons. And no one knows how many rounds were fired or how many statues were knocked down. But when the land forces arrived and the signal was given for them to attack, the admiral couldn't respond because he had used up all of his ammunition shooting at the saints. Now, I say that to tell you that there are a lot of Christians that will only battle when it concerns their faith when they're shooting at other saints. Do you believe that? It happens. It's sad. It's really sad, but it happens. I think most of you would agree with me when I say Christianity today is definitely a house divided. When we say that, I mean, I'm talking about Christianity in general, across the world, but especially in the United States. We are so divided. It seems that our faith is ebbing and flowing, that we're not all on the same page. And that was never Jesus' intent. You know, that was not what he wanted for the church, especially when he made that prayer, when he said that we would be one like him and the Father were one. That's how he wants us to be as the church. Well, in our focal passage of Scripture today, in the Gospel of Mark, we read in verse 22 of chapter 3, "And the scribes which came down from Jerusalem said, He hath Beelzebub, and by the prince of the devils casteth out devils." So we have these religious guys, these scribes. These guys are supposed to be learned in all things Scripture. Of the Old Testament. They're supposed to know all of the Bible. They're supposed to know the text. They're supposed to know the context of those texts. And they were known for the technical parts of the Old Testament. Well, in our own passage of Scripture today, it was clear that these scribes, they were sent to listen to Jesus, to see if they could find any technical error or theological mistake in Jesus' teachings. You know, he had already had this reputation. People were starting to follow. People were starting to listen. He had even preached in the synagogues already. But these scribes, you know, it doesn't take a whole lot of smarts to figure out that they were probably sent by the Pharisees, because the Pharisees hadn't been able to find any way to trap Jesus in order to persecute him or to take him down a peg, to reduce his following. But these so-called experts, these scribes, weren't really cracked up to be what they were supposed to be. They say that Jesus was possessed by the Lord of the Flies, Beelzebub, and they referred to him as the prince of demons. They said that Jesus was casting out demons by this demonic power. So this reference comes from 2 Kings chapter 1, when King Uzziah fell through the lattice work of his roof at his house, and he hurt his leg. So he sent some messengers to ask Beelzebub, the god of high places, the god of the Philistine city Ekron, whether he was going to live or whether he was going to die from his injury. Well, the Canaanite god name was changed in Hebrew to Beelzebub, which translates to the Lord of Dung, or in some translations, the Lord of Flies. I kind of like the Lord of Dung better, don't you? I mean, just really paints the right picture. In any case, this change denotes filth, and those Hebrew writers, they proclaim that this was the name of the prince of demons. Now today, most of us recognize that name Beelzebub as one of Satan's other names. And even Jesus uses that name in Matthew 10, verse 25, when he says, "It is enough for the disciple that he be as his master and the servant as his Lord. If they have called the master of the home, the house, Beelzebub, how much more shall they call them of his household?" Now, while this confirms the fact of Satan and his role in this world, the scribe's technical accuracy has a lot to be desired. So Jesus, from those statements to that these scribes were spreading around, Jesus has three things to say about that in our focal passage of Scripture in Mark 3, verses 22 through 30. And I'm going to be breaking the verses down as we go this time. Our first place we're going to stop is, sometimes we don't know what we think we know. Would that be accurate? How many times have you been in a conversation, you knew exactly what you were talking about, and then somebody educated you? Right? You have just enough information in your brain to be dangerous. That's what my mother used to always tell me. If I had more brains, I would be dangerous. I don't know what she meant by that. I don't think I was offended till just now when I thought about it. Mankind's knowledge is incomplete, and it's going to continue to be incomplete until Jesus completes us in glory. All we have to do is to look at our biblical knowledge, right? How many of you would say that you know the Bible pretty good? You guys are playing it safe. It's interesting, to say the least, when you're sitting around with a bunch of people and you're watching a program or a movie that's something on TV that's based on the Bible. Have you ever done that and listened to how people have learned the stories of the Bible? I mean, you learn what people know and what they don't know. What's in the pages between the covers of God's Word. Oftentimes, it's information that needs just a little bit of tweaking towards the truth. Information that's really supported by Scripture, because that's what we want. We want that information to be supported by the Bible, right? And what happens is, it's too often we read something and we haven't prayed about it and we haven't read before and after, and we make a decision on what that Scripture says. I'm telling you right now, when you read the Bible, you can't just read one verse and write a sermon on it. You can't make a decision on one verse without reading what goes before it and what goes after it, so that you know what it's talking about. And then the Spirit will lead you through that. And so many Christians only use bits and pieces of Scripture to bolster their cause, whatever that might be. Well, in Mark 3, verses 23 and 26, let's read that. The Bible says, "And he called them unto him, and said unto them in parables, How can Satan cast out Satan? And if a kingdom be divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house be divided against itself, that house cannot stand. And if Satan rise up against himself and be divided, he cannot stand, but hath an end." May God add his blessing to the reading of his word. See, these scribes, these men, they were accusing Jesus to his face. They weren't doing it to his face. They were actually doing it behind his back. They were going around telling other people that Jesus was healing these people. That he was able to do these miracles because of the power of Satan. That he was Satan. And Jesus responds to them by doing what? What you got to love about Jesus, he didn't shy around about anything, didn't he? He called him. He called him out. He said, "Come on over here. Let's talk a minute." This accusation warrants a confrontation. Jesus was about to let them know that they didn't know what they were talking about. They thought they knew. They were scholars and in as religionists, but they didn't know what they were saying. And so we got to love when Jesus educates us, right? They didn't, but we have to. We should. So Jesus makes his first point with our second point, which is a house divided can't stand. Why in the world would Satan be divided against himself? Jesus is pointing out just how silly that claim that the scribes made was. That's like, I'm going to stand up here, I'm going to preach about what a bad preacher I am. Would that make sense? It might be funny, but does that make sense? Why would Satan do that? Satan can't heal. Satan can't save lives. He can't give lives. He can't bring salvation to anybody. He can't be everywhere at the same time. If he had somebody on his team that was doing good and doing holy things, do you think that he's going to let them be there and do that stuff? No. And there's so many programs today that try to paint Satan as, you know, he's not a bad guy. Anybody ever watch that show, Lucifer? I'm not saying it's bad, but you see what I'm saying, right? Through that show, it makes him look like he's not all that bad, right? It's funny, but that's not the case. Jesus would not allow somebody on his team to do any good or holy things. And so that principle can be flipped around. What about the church? Then when I speak the church, I talk about the church international, universal. Is the church divided? Absolutely. Are we all pulling in the same direction? Even in our little church here, are we all pulling in the same direction? Do we all have the same hearts with the same vision that God has put inside of us, inside this church? And if we're honest, probably not always, right? I mean, there could be somebody out there that really doesn't like me, but they come because this is their church. That could happen, right? They endure each other. There are some that aren't pulling at all, which means that that's still part of the division, isn't it? Because they're not doing anything. What a difference that we could make for Christ in welcome in our community if we all pulled in the same direction. Wouldn't that be awesome? Now, I'm not saying that we're always going to think the same. We're not always going to be on the same page as far as how we think things should be. But everything should be going that way, right? Going towards the cross, going through towards a kingdom of God. Not going backwards, not going against itself. Brothers and sisters, you have to believe, you need to understand that Satan loves division, not only in society and in culture, but especially in a church. Those who enjoy division, regardless of what that issue is, regardless of whether they think it's religion or Christ's bent or whatever, it isn't. If it's causing a lack of unity, then they are working for the devil. Mark 3:27 tells us, no man can enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods, except he will first bind the strong man, and then he will spoil his house. See, Jesus is making a rebuttal here to these scribes, technical religionists. If you're going to break into somebody's house and take his stuff, especially if he's a strong person, a strong man, then the Bible says you ought to tie him up, right? Who do you think Jesus is talking about? And what do you think this has to do with these accusations against the scribes? If you break into the house of a strong man, you've got to do one of two things. You either got to convince that strong man that what you're doing to his house, what you're taking, is going to make him better. You got a chance of doing that? If you can't do that, then you need to tie him up. See, Jesus came to seek and to save those who were lost. And he's breaking into Satan's territory. You've heard Satan be called the Lord of this world, right? The Lord of this world. And Jesus has come into his territory, into his domain. And he's taken souls. He's taken those people that should be that Satan just knew were going to hell, and he's taken them. He's saving them. For Jesus to cast out demons and to take over the hearts of men and women, Satan wouldn't have just sat quietly by and let that happen, would he? I mean, Jesus' very presence defeated Satan. It tied him up. It made him powerless to what Jesus was doing. And Jesus was telling the scribe that everybody else, that not only was he taking Satan's domain, but that he was going to beat him. He was telling them that I have defeated this world, the Lord of this world. He is a defeated foe. Amen? Now, we should remember when Jesus started his ministry. And what did Satan do? Do you remember that? Those temptations? You remember that part of the Bible? Satan tried to take him out of the game. Satan threw the roots of every temptation in the world at Jesus. Everything that tempts us, Satan threw at Jesus. And praise the Lord, Jesus knocked them out of the park. He didn't fall for him. And the next time that Satan would throw a pitch at Jesus, he would hit him. He would knock him down. It was in his persecution and the cross. But Satan didn't realize that that was driving in the winning run right there. That was a home run. 1 Corinthians 15, verses 55 through 57 tells us, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is in the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus won, right? He defeated him for all of us. In verses 28 through 30, it says, Verily I say unto you, all sins shall be forgiven unto the sons of men, and the blasphemies wherewith soever they shall blaspheme. But he that shall blaspheme against the Holy Ghost hath never forgiveness, but is in danger of eternal damnation, because they said he hath an unclean spirit. May God add his blessing to reading his word right there. See, Jesus finishes this conversation with one of the sternest warnings in the Bible. And that's our third and final point today. It's an unforgivable sin, a terrifying thought. The scribes were actually attributing the works of God, the acts of God through Jesus, to Satan. Do we hear about that today? Do you hear about preachers that are reaching people for the lost? They get accused of speaking blasphemous things. No, you know why? Because Satan's letting them be there. Bible tells us there are going to be false prophets. There are going to be false teachers that are going to come, that they're going to tickle our ears, that they're going to lead people away. Don't be one of those. Being a Christian is not supposed to be easy. It's supposed to be joyous. But it's going to be tough, especially as things continue to go on the way they are. So Jesus gave them this warning. There's a whole lot of sins, brothers and sisters, that are forgivable. But there's only one that's not. How many of us believe that we are not good enough for God to save us? How many people listening out there believe that you are unsavable, that your past cannot be overcome? There's no way that a holy God would ever love me. I know I can speak for myself. That's how I felt. I still can't believe that he loves me that much, but I know that he does. How many of us have thought that We've committed sins that God would never forgive, could never forgive. I mean, doesn't that thought of just terrify you of not ever being forgiven? Knowing that you would be damned to hell? Can we commit the unforgivable sin? Can we step across the line of doom for which there is no way out? I'm going to give you some things to consider. Blasphemy. The word blasphemy means to speak against. Now, why is not speaking against Father God unforgivable? Why is not speaking against the Son Jesus unforgivable? But why is speaking against the Holy Spirit unforgivable? What's the difference? Aren't they three in one? Isn't the triune God? So let me let you consider this. We first have to the position of God. Right? God the Father, he represents the place of God. In Psalm 43:3, it says, O seed, out of thy light and thy truth, let them lead me, let them bring me unto the holy hill and to thy tabernacles. In Psalm 91:9, it tells us, because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. God is a place of righteousness. And we cannot get there by ourselves, right? We can't get there because we need a way. We need a way to God. And we already know that Jesus, the Son, our Savior, represents to us the way to God. Amen? Anybody disagree with that? John 10:1 says, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that entereth not by the door into the sheepfold, but climbeth up some other way, the same as a thief and a robber. John 14:6 is familiar to you. Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man, no person cometh unto the Father but by me. Then in Matthew 7:13, enter ye in the strait or the narrow gate, for the wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to the destruction, and many there be which go into thereat. And then one verse later in verse 14, Matthew 7:14. Because straight is the gate and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, but few there be that find it. See, that's the problem. That's the problem with the world. That's the problem with the church, is that way, that broad way, that way that makes it easy to come to God is not the true way. Going through that wide gate means that you're on the road to destruction. You're on your road to damnation. It's that narrow gate, that's that harder road, that more narrow road that we need to walk, which means that we have to be different. We have to look to God and get on that way, follow Christ, the way, the only way. But see, the problem is that we can't find that way on our own, can we? I mean, that's the scary thing about after the tribulation. I mean, after the rapture. You know, the rapture when Jesus comes in the sky. He doesn't come. It's not his second coming. He comes in the sky and he takes all of the saints that are living, and he takes them up to him. First, he takes all the people that are in the graves and they're gone, and then he takes us, and he takes us up. We disappear. When we disappear, brothers and sisters, guess what happens? The Holy Spirit leaves with us. The Holy Spirit leaves the earth with us. That means that anybody left on earth are going to have to find Jesus on their own. They're going to have to come to that decision on their own without any leading, without anybody helping them. No one supernatural anyway. Do you know how hard that is? Think about your life before you came to Christ, thinking you were doing the right thing. John 16, verses 7 through 13. Says, nevertheless, I tell you, this is Jesus. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. And when he is come, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment, and of sin because they believe not on me, of righteousness because I go unto my Father and ye see me no more, of judgment because the prince of this world is judged. I have yet many things to say unto you, but ye cannot hear them now. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. We can't do this life without him. We can't be a Christian without the Holy Spirit. You understand that, right? We need him to show us the way. And once we come to Christ, we still need him the rest of our lives. As we continue to make this walk, the Spirit of God, think about him as a movement. You know, the Holy Spirit is a movement along the way to get to where God is. When we study about the Holy Spirit, there's always movement. And when that movement is always towards God, it always is. And that movement, brothers and sisters, is always through Jesus, the way. It's the only way to God, right? Jesus had come to show people the way to God, and he had did nothing on his own, but only what the Father did through him. He got all of his instructions, all of his power from the Father through the Holy Spirit. You've read his prayers when he's talking to the Father, right? He made himself available to be used by God through the Spirit to move people to the way of God. And those scribes came with an attitude. They couldn't refute what they saw. They saw what he was doing. So they tried to refute the source of the power that Jesus had done good with. So they were saying that his power came from Satan. He was Satan. His power came from Satan. And in doing that, they resisted the Holy Spirit of God, who was trying to move them into the way of God. We know so many people in our lives that are doing that right now, that haven't made that decision, that the Holy Spirit has plucked at them, that you have planted that seed, that you have showed them some way, shape, or form of Christ, and yet they won't come there. They won't go there. They don't want to talk about it. I know people near and dear to me that just don't. And it breaks our hearts, doesn't it? Brothers and sisters, you need to hear me now. If you never allow the Holy Spirit to move you into the way of God, there is no hope. There isn't. Every week I tell you to do a checkup on yourself to make sure that what you feel, what you know, who you know in Christ is real. It's not just something that you said, but that you feel. Because dying while holding on to the attitude of rebellion against the Holy Spirit is eternal damnation. We might have some pretenders here. The Bible tells us that the church is going to have pretenders throughout its history. And they look like the rest of us. They say the right things. But they have no spiritual fruit. They have no spiritual fruit because the Holy Spirit is not in them. Beloved, the world is against the church. You see that more and more. You read about it. If you're not paying attention to the news, as much as I hate it, you need to be smart. We need to know what's going on. As much as it gets your blood pressure up, you need to know what's going on. That means that we need to listen to the Holy Spirit. We need to watch. Because this world is doing all that it can to divide us. Everything. On every level of our lives. It's using race and gender, social status, education, religion. You name it. It's using all of that to divide us. And we're letting it happen. And you know what's happening by us letting it happen? Satan's smiling. There is no way in the world that we should be divided. We should be together. That's what scares the government, right? If we all were together on the same page, realizing most of the junk that they throw at us is division, is not division, should bring us together. Oh my goodness. Forget about denominations, forget about political parties, forget about all of that and come together as God's people. One big family. This world, this country, just the country, those politicians would be frightened to death. Imagine that. Us coming together all at once, standing up against those people that don't have my, well, I'm not going to get political. Sorry. Anyway, none of them. I pray the Holy Spirit starts to lead us. Start to lead us. I want to make Satan frown. I want to make him cry because he's losing more and more people, not gaining more and more. So, let me ask you, do you embrace the Holy Spirit? That's between you and God. Or are you a divider? Do you like division? And I'll tell you to your face or to the camera, if you like division, then you're doing the work of Satan. It says it right in here. And I believe this, not the internet. Let's pray. Father, I know that that maybe I spent a little extra time this morning. But I truly do, as a pastor and as a man hate division. I hate it in families. I hate it in our culture. I hate it in the church. And Lord, when that first church came to being, everybody was together. Everybody. It didn't matter. The only thing they had was Christ. That was their linchpin, that glue. That's all we need. Against division in the church, against division in our lives. And at this little church in Welcome, Maryland, can overcome all the divisions that gets thrown at it and only see what the Holy Spirit leads us to and through Christ. Then, Father, you will bless us. And I can't speak for everybody, but my goodness, I would much rather have you bless me than rebuke me. Give us a heart, Father, to follow your Spirit. We pray that you give us the words and the love to continue to reach out to those that reject the Holy Spirit, pushing them towards the way. Towards Jesus and towards you. Continue to bless this church, Father, I pray. Each man, woman, and child I'm thankful for. And I pray that you bless them and their families for being here today. We thank you for Jesus, our Lord and Savior, who on that day confronted those scribes and told us that we are not lost, and only if we grieve the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Father, for each man, woman, and child here and listening today. We give you the glory, honor, and praise in the precious name of Jesus Christ. All God's children said, amen. I apologize if I ran on today. I didn't mean to. Division is, I just hate it. I just hate it. In any case.
We got victory, amen?
Amen.
Let's clap. Let's give God. We give him the glory, right?
Amen.
He sent the Holy Spirit to us. He gives us the Holy Spirit to guide us. Here's your challenge. It's going to be a tough one this week. It's going to be an important one. It's going to say a lot about where you are in your Christian walk. You're going to go to somebody that you know is grieving the Holy Spirit, rejecting the Holy Spirit. And you're going to tell them about Jesus. You don't have to beat them up. It can be a conversation that's really easy by just going, "Where do you go to church?" And they'll start laughing. "I go to church, so what's happening now?" And you're just going to tell them what Jesus has done for you. That's it. What is Jesus? I mean, he's done, I presume he's done something for you guys, right?
Yes, amen.
Okay. Somebody in your life that you know has resisted the Holy Spirit's. One person. You got all week to think about it and worry about it and get anxious about it. Or you just go right to the source. Go home today on the phone, you say, "Hey, let's have some coffee." Right? Can you do that? Oh, I know most of you are going, "I ain't doing that." But I pray that you will, because it's important. It's important that you get over that fear of rejection, that other people are going to put you down. And reach people for Christ. Tell them what happens. That's when you're really brave. Can you do that? I think you can. I know that you can. God bless you. I love you guys. You know, if you need me, please call. Stop by. Have an awesome week. Stay hydrated. Leo, you want to close this?
Sure. Let's pray.
Peace.
Father, we thank you for your words. We thank you, Father, for our pastor and Father, for the time and putting them together for us and for your spirit and leading them. And I do pray, Father, that these words have encouraged us to do what he's asked us to do. And Father, we pray as we prepare to do those things, Father, that as in anything that we do, that we are preparing, that we are seeking your Holy Spirit and guidance and strength to do so, Father. Father, no one likes rejection. And if anything we can remember is that it's not against us, it's against you. So Father, we reach these people in love and we pray for them, Father, and pray the Holy Spirit will move in their hearts. I do pray, Father, you bless us throughout this week. Give us the strength, Father, that we need to get through it. We thank you, we praise you, and we ask all this in Jesus' name. Thank you.